What's up, everybody? I'm Jesse Showalter, and today we're talking about the state of design tools at the end of 2018. There's so many options, and they have a lot of similarities, but they have a lot of unique features. So today we're gonna be talking about those differences, what sets them apart, what makes them similar, and what might be the right fit for you. I'm also gonna be mentioning some tools to look out for in 2019, as well as my predictions for just where design tools are going in general. So with all that being said, let's get started. Okay, let's kick this thing off by talking about current design tools that are available to all of us right now. First up on the list, let's talk briefly about Sketch for Mac, which is basically the granddaddy of digital design tools at this point. It has things like reusable symbols and multiple art boards, and now we have shared libraries, so your whole team can share one library of symbols. You have nested symbols and overrides. It makes creating reusable components at large scales like really, really easy to do. Sketch is also really, really famous for allowing users to soup up the program by adding plugins and extensions, whether they're paid or free. This allows you to really tailor your workflow and dial it in the way that you want. In recent years, Sketch has been adding some other features like sharing via Sketch Cloud, basic screen-to-screen prototyping, and now they've introduced data. Sketch is just an all-around really, really good design tool if you're starting out. It's really, really fast. It's really performant. It does what it does really, really well. There are some other tools that have been recently adding other components like real-time collaboration and sharing, and maybe not only screen-to-screen prototyping, but really detailed, complex kind of motion and timeline animation stuff. So if that's what you're looking for, Sketch doesn't have that right now, but it is super solid, and I gotta be honest, it's the thing that I use still almost every day in my design work. So it's working really, really good. I think it's probably gonna have to pick up the pace to compete with some of the other cool features that are out there and some of the other tools. Okay, next up on the list, you can't talk about Sketch without talking about Figma. Figma is, in my mind, probably the second most popular design tool. Everybody's kind of talking about it right now. I think one of the benefits of Figma is it's not just for the Mac like Sketch, but it's for all platforms as well as being used in the browser. It is browser-based, so I have seen a dip in performance compared to local platforms like Sketch, but it's not so bad that you don't want to use it. It's still pretty snappy. It works really, really good. Figma does a lot of the things you would expect it to do, especially if you're a Sketch user. It has reusable components. It has libraries that you can share. It can tap into data and do all those basic design things, but it also brings a real-time kind of collaboration component and version control, which is really, really nice. You can be working on the same, you know, document with five other people in your design team. You can see their you know, cursor moving around and doing things. And it feels really nice that way. I also really like the embedded commenting system that's in Figma. So I can create my designs and then immediately share that design with somebody right there in Figma. They can comment on it. And now we don't have some sort of external commenting and iterative process. It's all contained right there in Figma. It has basic prototyping in it as well, basic previewing. You can mirror it on your phone just like you can on Sketch. There's a lot of those same elements as Sketch. It just brings that browser-based kind of collaborative and sharing aspect to it with a small performance dip, in my opinion. I think Figma is an awesome design tool. I think it's especially awesome if you work in a large design team with mixed platforms. Some people on PC, some people on Apple, some people want to work in the browser. You don't want to overwrite each other's work. You can collaborate and comment. If that's you, Figma might be a great choice for you because it offers a lot of those little things to kind of keep you inside the platform and not have to go other places. Okay, next up on the list is Adobe XD, Adobe Experience Designer. So Adobe XD has been around for a year or two. It was in beta first. It was really, really basic, like basic shapes, basic prototyping. That was kind of it. But they've slowly kind of built it out, made it a little bit more robust. It has more features. It's a little bit more powerful. It integrates directly into Illustrator and After Effects and Photoshop. So you can kind of continue to work within the ecosystem of Adobe if that's what you like to do. They've also been building out some really cool features like private sharing and voice triggers and now auto animate. So you don't have like really complex controls over what moves and where, but it feels very much like a Keynote kind of like magic animate thing where from, you know, screen A to screen B, if elements have changed, it'll just auto animate things back and forth. So that's kind of cool. It brings a little bit extra to the prototyping kind of aspect of Adobe XD. I don't know what else to say about Adobe XD. It feels really solid. It looks really good. It works really, really well. It has some, but not all the things that you want. It's not really fully integrated with like really built out animation stuff or collaboration stuff. That stuff's still kind of like minimal, but I have a feeling that like it's gonna get there because they're kind of slow and steady kind of along the path. So Adobe XD, pretty good, check it out. Next up, let's talk about Framer, and specifically let's talk about Framer X, because they moved from Framer, which was more of like a code-based prototyping tool, into Framer X, which is supposed to be a full-blown design tool. Framer X has some interesting features, like you're able to create things called stacks where you can kind of rearrange and move things around. Once you create a layout and you need to kind of enter in data, you can do that really quickly. It has a built-in store so you can find reusable components that are all customizable. It also has prototyping, like basic screen-to-screen prototyping. Nothing super duper complex timeline animation stuff, but basic screen-to-screen. You can also preview on your phone, I believe, and share it with other people so they can see links. You know, it feels pretty good, but I feel like as a screen design tool, what Framer X is lacking are some of those basics, some of those core things that make something like Sketch or Figma feel really, really good. Like the basic screen design tools like shapes and pen tools and making vectors, like making icons in Framer X is not really a thing right now, at least, or last time I touched or played with it. It feels like they focused on some of those differentiating factors like stacks and marketplace more than they did the basic design tools. I know that Framer X is going to grow, it's gonna change, but as of right now in 2018, it doesn't feel like a very full-formed design tool that I think a lot of people would use in production right now. I could be wrong, but that's just my two cents. Next up on the list is Affinity Designer, made by a company called Serif. They also have Affinity Photo and the new Affinity Publisher. These are kind of competitors to Adobe Photoshop and InDesign, and Affinity Designer is the competitor, I would say, to Adobe Illustrator. It's a vector-based design tool that's robust and really fully formed, so it's not just about prototyping and product design and UX design and UI design. It's about vector design as a whole. With that being said, it has some screen-related kind of design features to it. It has some reusable components and symbols. It has art boards, but that's pretty much it. It doesn't have prototyping. There's no collaborative sharing. There's no real-time aspect. It's very much like Illustrator. There is some good things about using Affinity Designer to do product design or web design. It's really fully featured as a vector tool. Not only can you do logos and icons and web design work, but you can also do things like vector painting and go back and forth between workspaces and work in a pixel mode and work in a vector mode. It's really robust, and I would say that it's for more than just product design or web design, but for vector design in general. So that's Affinity Designer. Next up on the list is Invision Studio. This is the new design platform by Invision, who are kind of the masters of kind of prototyping, screen-to-screen prototyping and sharing and collaborative stuff for designers and design teams. Everybody knows about Invision. And Invision Studio was their big push, their big hype to introduce a new design tool. And it was supposed to be not just a design tool, but also a sharing tool and a really in-depth animating and prototyping tool and a collaborative tool. It's supposed to be all of it built into one, built on the Invision kind of platform. So you can have a free account at Invision and use some of the basics, but there are some limitations. I don't know what the limitations are to Invision Studio. Right now it's free to sign up and start using it, but I'm sure there will be some limitations kind of dependent on your monthly plan or what subscription you have. The tool itself is really, really nice. It works really, really well. You can use it for multiple different platforms. It has great, robust design tools, as well as components, reusable components, libraries. It plugs into their design system manager, so you have like a reusable library that you can share between teams. It has really in-depth animating. This is the only one on the list that has really nitty-gritty animating built right in. Like, you can have multiple components on the screen, you can make a new artboard, you can roll up the timeline, decide how everything wants to move, you can, you know, the different interactions between things. So it is a much more in-depth prototyping tool built right into the design tool as well. It works really good. It feels really nice. They are also, I think, soon building in like a marketplace similar to Framer. So like plugins and extensions, like everyone's moving towards that, which is good because I think it allows you to kind of like take the platform to the next level that works for you. So they're trying to be everything, I think. And so far, it seems like they're doing a pretty good job. So my only concern is that it's built into kind of a monthly proprietary thing with Invision. So if you're not into Invision, you probably aren't gonna be able to use Studio. So that's my only fear, is that it's so hooked into that whole system that it may be a deterrent for some designers to use. So, but definitely really well put together, really polished, and a joy to use. Okay, next up on the list is an application that I'm really excited about. I've signed up for early access, haven't gotten in yet. So that's why I'm saying look out for it in 2019, and that is Phase. Phase is supposed to be a new design tool that reimagines and reworks the way that we do design. I think it's supposed to have all those core kind of, you know, screen related design tools like symbols and libraries and basic design tools. But I think where Phase is really trying to take it is state-based design and not just flat design that you try to then implement the different states to it. I think it's trying to create something that is right away making designers think about all the different states right there on the artboard. So I'm excited to see what comes of Phase, and that's kind of what my eyes are on for next year. Okay, next up, let's talk about my predictions for how design tools just tend to be going, and what we can expect for next year and beyond. I think companies are gonna be trying to build design tools that include more of the design process. No longer will they say, here's where you do the design, go elsewhere to figure out prototyping. They're gonna say, here's where you do the prototyping and the design and the sharing and the collaborating and the whatever else they can think of. They're gonna try to expand what they do to be more all-encompassing. I think Invision Studio is doing a lot of that. I think Figma is trying to do a lot of that. I think Sketch and some of the others are trying to catch up and do more and more of that. So I just think more of the design process built into one platform is what people are looking for and what design tool creators are trying to make. Next up, I would say more collaboration. Expect way more collaboration to be built into tools in general. I think Figma really blew people's mind when they came on the scene and said, we can work in real time. A lot of people called it like the Google Drive of design tools, and that's true, but it offers so much more. It's the version control, it's the real time, you know, collaboration, it's the commenting system built right into it. So you don't have to go out to something like a Dropbox or a real time boards. You can just keep it right there. So I work remote, so I need to be able to have that feeling, that sensation of looking over at the other designer on my team, seeing her screen, seeing what she's doing, and working off of each other based on what we see. So I think there's gonna be more collaboration built into everything from now on. All right, next prediction is just more extensions, more plugins, more marketplaces, more places for people to go to stay committed to the platform. I think that's something that Sketch did, and they were really, really smart. They allowed developers to create a community, and so you have so many plugins you love to use. Not only paid plugins, but free plugins that have just become such a, you know, part of your workflow that you don't wanna sacrifice them or surrender them. And I think more people are catching on to that. They really want to offer people more, see what the community can come up with, and allow people to tailor it to their workflow. That makes them feel like they're home, right? So more marketplaces, more extensions, more plugins. And lastly, I didn't talk about it when I was covering all the programs, but I think more code. Programs that offer you the ability to see some sort of outputted code, whether it's HTML and CSS, or it is Swift or Android Studio code. Code is just, it's a big part of what we do if you're building websites and products, because we have to hand those things off to engineering teams. Why not include the engineering team in what we're designing and making from the start? And to include them, you gotta include their language, right? Speak their language. And I think code is gonna be a huge thing that comes in design tools. Well, that's the state of design tools in 2018, in my opinion. There's lots of stuff going on. It was a longer video. Thanks to you guys if you watched the whole thing. If you did enjoy it, make sure to leave a thumbs up, subscribe to the channel. I do lots of videos about design and development and tools just like this one, so maybe stick around. If you have any questions, leave them down in the comments. I hope you guys are having an amazing week designing amazing things, making amazing things, and finding the right tools for you. I'll see you in the next one.